Wonderful. So let's get started. I'm Taylor Frabel, Director of the Security Studies Program here at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. I'm absolutely delighted to welcome our speaker, Jonathan Hillman, who is a Senior Fellow with the CSIS Economics Program and Director of the Reconnecting Asia Project, one of the most extensive open source databases that tracks China's Belt and Road Initiative, and as well as other infrastructure projects across the Eurasian supercontinent. He's the author of a new book, The Emperor's New Road, China and the Project of the Century, which he will be talking about today. Absolutely a terrific book. He's testified before Congress, briefed government officials and Fortune 500 executives, as well as written on economics and security for all the usual places, the Financial Times, the National Interest, the Wall Street Journal, Washington Post, et cetera. Prior to joining CSIS, Hillman served as a policy advisor at the Office of the U.S. Trade Representative, where he contributed to the 2015 U.S. National Security Strategy, as well as the President's Trade Agenda, and directed the research and writing process for essays, speeches, and other materials explaining U.S. Trade and investment policy. Prior to that, he also worked as a researcher at the Belfer Center down the road, at the Council on Foreign Relations, and was a Fulbright scholar in Kyrgyzstan. He's a graduate of the Harvard Kennedy School, where he was a presidential scholar, and Brown University. So Jonathan, welcome to MIT, even virtually. We're absolutely delighted to have you here today. And I now want to turn over the virtual floor to you.
Great, thank you, Taylor, so much for the invitation to do this. You know, when I was a student at the Kennedy School, don't tell them this, but my favorite two courses were actually courses I took at MIT. One course with Barry Posen on military power, and then a course with Cindy Williams on military budgeting. And so, you know, I sort of feel like maybe I picked the wrong program, but really, really enjoyed my time there. Let me share my screen here so that I can use a few slides. Okay, so hopefully that's coming through.
Looks great.
Okay, so you know, here's the game plan for today. I'm gonna try to be relatively efficient because I do wanna leave, you know, a decent amount of time for questions and comments and conversation. This book is really organized mainly geographically. And so I've got chapters on different regions and, you know, many of which I was able to visit and look at projects. And the goal of the book and the goal of the work that I've been doing at CSIS for 4 years is trying to really get a better sense for what's actually happening on the ground with these projects and in some cases what's not happening. You know, there's, you know, for every project that is announced, you know, only a handful of, you know, a smaller fraction of them actually become real ultimately, and many encounter problems along the way. The book is also, it has a good amount of history. It's sort of a combination of some travel and then also a decent amount of history. And, you know, I try to use history as kind of a yardstick to compare what China is doing to what its predecessors have done, you know, in different regions, different parts of the world. China is not the first rising power to try to do large infrastructure projects beyond its border. And so I have some interesting comparisons between, you know, what Japan was doing in Southeast Asia in the 1970s and 1980s. You know, I'm struck by a lot of, you know, similar criticisms and anxiety today as there was at that point about Japan's activities. You know, Japan was accused of using loans with interest rates that were too high and favoring its own companies and also was embroiled in some corruption scandals. And I think though that, you know, the Japanese learned from that experience and, you know, they do bring different standards today to doing their projects. In some cases, China's actually following in the footsteps of the United States not so long ago. You know, the U.S. As part of its AFPAC strategy announced that it would be, you know, spending significant sums on large, visible infrastructure projects in Pakistan. And we can go even further back. And, you know, one of my favorite historical anecdotes is that Gwadar Port, which is in Pakistan and gets a lot of attention today as, you know, potentially a future Chinese naval facility. Gwadar Port was originally offered to President Richard Nixon. And it, you know, that offer included an offer to use it as a naval facility. And so, you know, the U.S. National Security Council did a sort of assessment about whether or not that would be a smart thing to do. And their reading of that at the time was, this is a project that's probably, you know, more about sort of serving a domestic political agenda in Pakistan. Its success, its commercial success is pretty uncertain. It's going to anger a lot of the people, a lot of countries in the region. And I think many of those things still hold true today, although China has decided to go ahead with it. So there's a lot of history in the book. Today, what I'd like to do, though, is to sort of provide more of a chronological narrative of how the Belt and Road has unfolded since it was announced in 2013. And so I'll try to do this in three parts. The first part is some of the hype around the Belt and Road when it was announced initially. I think, you know, a lot of us are going to be familiar with this, so I won't spend too much time on that. I think the reality, this is the second part, the reality has been quite disappointing for a lot of participants. You know, some of that was, I think, inevitable given a lot of the lofty rhetoric and the promises that were made. But I'll show some data too about what's happening in some cases, not happening in different regions. And then finally, I think this is the most interesting part, is sort of what's coming, you know, what's down the road here. And I've got a few thoughts on that. Particularly, you know, this is not an initiative that is static, right? So the Belt and Road, as it was announced in 2013, is very different than the Belt and Road that exists today, and, you know, that will probably exist next year. So I'll try to spend the most time on that forward-looking part of this. So just to take us back to when the Belt and Road was announced in 2013. This is a recreation of a map that one of the Chinese state media outlets used, I think, around 2014 or 2015, and it captures, you know, the two major dimensions of the Belt and Road, at least as it was announced originally. So there's the overland belt, and then, somewhat confusingly, the maritime road. And, you know, in a lot of ways, this map actually understates what the Belt and Road is, and in some ways it overstates what it is. And so I think it understates what the Belt and Road has become, in the sense that it's really expanded well beyond this geography. So you now have, you know, activities that have been announced in the Arctic, you know, much more in Africa, Latin America, cyberspace, and even outer space, right? This thing has just continued to expand and expand. There's still no definition for what qualifies as a Belt and Road project. And I think that was certainly an intentional decision. And, you know, it's given this a lot of political momentum. It's allowed people to repackage their activities as being part of the Belt and Road. But it's also created a real management challenge. It's tough to manage what you can't measure. And so without a criteria for what qualifies here, that's become quite difficult. Now, this map, though, it also understates what the Belt and Road is. And this is, you know, to me, this was the kind of the my own education and a lot of what ended up going into the book. You know, you look at a map like this, and it looks like, you know, the return of the Middle Kingdom almost, you know, these huge corridors resonating out from China, and, you know, in some cases, you know, a revival of the ancient Silk Routes, if you believe some of the, you know, propaganda around this, you know, and an idea that overland trade is going to become more competitive. But the reality is that a lot of these corridors still remain quite aspirational. And, you know, this also relates back to the management challenge that Chinese officials have faced. You know, so for it's quite easy to draw a corridor across a map. It's quite difficult to actually, you know, create economic activity where it hasn't been, or where it's been, you know, relatively limited. And so, you know, with the exception of the China-Pakistan economic corridor, which, you know, isn't actually a corridor, and we could talk more about that, there's not actually any evidence that suggests that there's more project activity happening within these corridors than there is outside of them. So this has been, you know, in practice, a much more opportunistic and much more fragmented set of activities than a map like this would suggest. In financial terms, you know, this is, again, this is a struggle to pin down an exact number for this because there's no criteria for what counts as a project, and the list of participating countries has expanded and expanded. But the number you often hear associated with this is that there's been $1 trillion in promised infrastructure investment. You know, so if we were to just try to put that in historical terms, the Marshall Plan, were it adjusted for inflation, you know, would be about a seventh of that size today. So, you know, this is a very significant, at least set of promised activities, according to, you know, the best data that I've seen, about $460 billion of construction contracts have been signed between China and countries participating in this, between 2013 and earlier this year. So let's say that, you know, roughly half, a little less than half of the promise has at least been materialized in contracts. Although, you know, I think it is important to point out that signing a contract still doesn't mean that the project will ultimately be delivered. And there's some important distinctions between the Marshall Plan and the Belt and Road. So, you know, I think one important point to point out here is that the Marshall Plan was very focused geographically, right? The Belt and Road has been expanding and expanding. I'll show a map in just a second of the participants. You know, countries that have signed cooperation agreements and MOUs. The Marshall Plan was very concentrated geographically. It operated over a finite period of time. The Belt and Road is open-ended and ever-expanding. And perhaps the most important difference, though, between these two things is that the Marshall Plan was focused on rebuilding economies that had already been developed. And that's a much easier thing to do than it is to develop economies, as I think China is learning. Now, if we, this map here was put together by Brookings a couple of weeks ago, and it shows countries that have signed MOUs. Those are the darker blue countries. The lighter blue is countries that have signed cooperation agreements. And, you know, in some ways, as Taylor and I were discussing just before this, in some ways, I think the MOU is actually the best sort of it best captures what the Belt and Road is and what it isn't. You know, it's not the deep sea port. It's not the rail project. It's the MOU. And a lot of these MOUs, at least the ones that have been made public, are pretty weak documents. You know, we shouldn't compare these to trade agreements. Many of them literally say on the bottom that they're not legally binding. I think in the early days of Belt and Road, they had, you know, more political importance as, you know, a little bit more weight as a signal of who's, you know, endorsing this. And countries were clearly signing on because they were hoping that in signing on, they would get some economic benefit from participating. But I think what's actually happened is, you know, the list of participants has continued to expand. And as I'll point out a bit later, the amount of resources that have been made available has decreased. So, you know, just as there are now more mouths to feed, the pie is shrinking. And that's, I think, a recipe for disappointment. And, you know, also, I think it comes out in this map, again, just the high level of participation among developing countries. Which, you know, where infrastructure needs in particular are quite, you know, acute. But, you know, these are also very risky business environments. And so I think it's only natural that China would encounter some difficulty as it pursues big projects in these environments. And the, you know, for the countries that have decided to not participate in this, that's also not been they haven't necessarily paid an economic cost for not participating in this. So, you know, the example that I like to think about is about a year ago, Italy literally rolled out the red carpet for Xi Jinping, signed a Belt and Road MOU. And then, you know, the Chinese delegation continued on to France, which did not sign an MOU, but did about 16 times the amount of deals just in terms of the overall financial amount. And so, you know, I think Italy has had buyer's remorse. And recently, I think the Italian foreign minister for European affairs said that it was a mistake. So participating in the Belt and Road is no guarantee of benefits. Not participating is also, you know, you can still do business with China, even if you don't participate. So now into the, you know, what has the experience actually been for countries that participate in this? One of the big promises, you know, from the earliest days of the Belt and Road, and something that's really, you know, hammered home if you ever go to a Belt and Road conference, is that, you know, this is a win-win initiative. And, you know, in reality, Chinese contractors have captured the lion's share of contracts. So for Chinese funded projects, this is a sample of projects we looked at about a year and a half, 2 years ago, mostly transport and energy projects, mostly financed by China Development Bank and China Exim. You see Chinese contractors are getting about 90% of that bucket of projects. I don't think that's surprising given that this is, you know, an initiative designed by China, given that it's putting it, you know, its own financing into this. And given the fact that China has very large state-owned enterprises who, you know, are probably the biggest immediate beneficiary a lot of these activities. So 7 of the world's 10 largest construction companies are, you know, have their headquarters in China. And in many cases, they have built so much domestically that they have essentially run out of things to build. And so they've been very eager participants in the Belt and Road. You also see, though, because of that scale, of the scale of those companies, Chinese contractors are still getting about 30% of our sort of comparison bucket of projects here of multilateral development bank projects. These were mostly Asian Development Bank and World Bank projects. So you see that they're still quite competitive, especially, you know, in this transport and energy space, but really dominating the contracts. And, you know, I think for countries participating in this who thought that there were going to be more opportunities for local companies, local workers, some of that has been disappointing. So I think it's, you know, it's impossible to talk about Belt and Road without talking about Pakistan. And that's because, you know, Chinese officials have said that the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor is the flagship corridor of the Belt and Road. But I think here again, the theme of, you know, great promises and somewhat disappointing results is also accurate. So people can, you know, disagree about what the baseline of announced projects were for CPEC. I've seen estimates ranging from, you know, in the low 60 billions to at one point closer to 100 billion when some large hydro projects were being floated. There's still been, you know, to be fair, there's still been a good amount of projects that have been delivered. So, you know, doing somewhere in the range of $20 to $25 billion of projects in Pakistan is still a lot of project activity. But, you know, if you compare it again to what has been announced, we're looking at, you know, a third maybe of what's been announced has been delivered. And, you know, I guess, you know, following through on a third of what you promise, I think for most people would not be considered a victory. You know, certainly getting a third of your questions right on an exam wouldn't be a great performance. Maybe it's okay if we're talking about baseball or, you know, as batting average, but I think again, this is, so we can disagree, you know, about sort of what the baseline is here, but I do think, again, only a fraction of what's been promised has been delivered. You also see with the special economic zones that have been announced in Pakistan, you know, only one has been complete, and most of them, very little has been done. And so if this is the flagship, I think, I don't know, if I were on the Chinese side, I might regret having made this the flagship. You might have picked an easier country in order to you know, deliver projects and you know, have some easier, earlier wins. Another region that China has been quite active in through the Belt and Road Initiative are the Western Balkans. And so this is some data that we collected as part of a project for the State Department. And again, just you know, the main takeaway here is that really only a fraction of what has been announced has been delivered. You see lots of projects being stalled. And in fact, I think that you know, more of the yellow projects here that have been announced are probably stalled than we actually have captured in this. And then in some regions, China has not been, you know, I think it's important to remember just you know, for context here that China is not the only country pursuing infrastructure projects. And in fact, Japan is still very active in Southeast Asia. In some places it's outspending China. You know, again, it's the incumbent in that region. You know, in many ways, China is falling in its footsteps. But this is, I think, one of the things that is not often captured, you know, when we look at Belt and Road in a vacuum. You know, there's other activity going on. And in some cases, China is not the biggest actor. So just to pivot here from what we've been seeing to what's ahead, you know, there has been a pretty significant decrease in project activity, even predating the pandemic. I think that's important to remember. So even before the pandemic really froze a lot of activity, you know, you saw a drop off. The peak Belt and Road years were probably 2016, 2017 in terms of announcements and activity. And you've seen a decline since then. And I think there are several explanations for why that's the case. Again, this has become a real management challenge on the Chinese side. The lack of criteria. China's method for delivering these projects is often done with little transparency, which I makes it easier to get projects started, but it also pushes lots of risk into the project process, which you know I think can come back to haunt those responsible for those projects. There's been really, I don't think, enough oversight. You know, I mentioned that China's state-owned enterprises are often the biggest beneficiaries of these activities. They're also on the ground, often the most influential actors. You know, they have, you know, they have more technical expertise, they have more personnel, and they often have, you know, more disposable resources than the Chinese officials in country that are supposed to be nominally supposed to be supervising them. And so I think that they have, in some cases, you know, influence project decisions that, you know, in ways that favor their short-term interests, but not necessarily China's longer-term interests in the places where those projects are being done. There's also the fact that large projects, this is according to research that a group at Oxford does on mega projects, large projects are typically, they typically cost more than expected, take longer than expected, and deliver fewer benefits than expected. And that's in the, you know, including in the best business environments in the world. And again, China has gone into some very difficult business environments under the banner of the Belt and Road. And there's been a, you know, I think feeding this and making it more difficult for China to cut losses is the fact that it's, you know, this is Xi Jinping's signature foreign policy vision. I think it's almost a universal challenge for people to cancel large infrastructure projects. The political incentives are not usually there. Everyone wants to be in the spotlight when a project is announced. No one really wants that attention when they're canceling something. But that sort of universal challenge becomes even more acute in the case of Belt and Road, because again, this is, you know, Xi Jinping's signature foreign policy vision, you know, enshrined in the Chinese Communist Party Constitution. And, so it's been remarkable that even as China's foreign ministry in June acknowledged that 20% of Belt and Road projects were seriously affected, I think were their words, by the pandemic, they still felt the need to point out that they were unaware of any large projects being canceled. So you would think that the pandemic would be the opportunity to cancel things and blame it on the pandemic. But there's been a reluctance to lean into that. And, you know, in the same way that the sort of the flip side of doing this, a lot of these activities bilaterally, favoring your own construction companies, doing the financing yourself. If you're the sort of flip side to trying to get the lion's share of the rewards, there are also, you know, you're stuck with a lot of the risk when things don't go well. And so I think there's been, significant financial and reputational risk that China faces. And I think some of this has been appreciated, certainly by Chinese officials. There's a learning process that's happening here. There's also some resiliency to this initiative. I think it's remarkable that this is a photo from the Second Belt and Road Forum. Standing in the front row, you have at least two leaders who campaigned against the Belt and Road. And then when, taking office, as many leaders do, wanted to keep their options open. And so they not only went to the Belt and Road Forum, but they took the stage and they endorsed it. And so I think this speaks to the fact that there's a really just continued demand for an investment, for infrastructure projects, in particular, and that demand is, it far exceeds what any single country can provide, including China. But that provides windows of opportunity, even when projects go wrong, that demand, I think, is not going away. So looking ahead, one of the really, I think, important trends to watch here is that as levels of project activity decline, I think we're looking at probably a smaller pipeline of projects, potentially, a higher tech set of activities. And so, Belt and Road 2.0 here, I think, could have a greater emphasis on digital infrastructure. And to be fair, digital infrastructure has been there all along in different ways, sometimes not immediately evident. So this is a photo of the port of Piraeus in Greece, which is probably one of the most commercially successful projects that's commonly identified with the Belt and Road. But the port of Piraeus in Greece is not just about moving shipping containers. After Costco, the state-owned Chinese state-owned shipping company, took over running two terminals there, they held a tender for redoing the port's network infrastructure. And so lo and behold, Huawei won the tender and has delivered the systems that you see here in the diagram on the right. And so I think if you were to go on a cruise ship into the port of Piraeus, you would get, briefly free Wi-Fi provided by Huawei. And so this has been part of the package, Belt and Road projects all along. Fiber optic lines are often laid alongside linear infrastructure because it's easier to do that when you're building a road or a rail project. Those activities have been there. But I think there's a new set of activities that will, or a set of activities that will get even more attention going forward. One example is what's sometimes called smart city technology, which is, there's no definition for what a smart city is, but can include many systems. And that's, I think, to China's advantage. A lot of Chinese companies market their version as a safe city with an emphasis on security. And you see in here, this is a roundup of agreements that we found between Huawei for its safe city equipment and other countries. And you see a really heavy emphasis on countries that are middle income and partly free in Asia and Africa. And, these are the markets of the future, right? This is the developing world. And so as Chinese companies encounter more scrutiny in Western markets, I think it's natural that they'll try to double down in some of these emerging markets, and the Belt and Road will remain, an important avenue for them to do that. Some other developments to watch. I think last Friday, Zambia became the first country to default on its debt during the pandemic. I think China is responsible for about quarter or a third of its debt. And that's a theme that I think we're going to see more of in the months to come. Over 100 countries have approached the IMF for debt relief. For most of them, China is their largest bilateral official creditor. And so I imagine that Chinese officials are spending more time renegotiating deals these days than they are spending negotiating new deals. Some of the management challenges of the Belt and Road have made international debt relief talks much more difficult. So the lack of transparency, the fragmentation, the fact that China Development Bank has one policy about how it's going to handle debt, China Exim Bank has another policy. If you're a recipient country here, you're dealing with a more fragmented process or more fragmented set of actors than we might have assumed. Another important potential trend here is, I think, an interest from the Chinese side in trying to multilateralize parts of the Belt and Road. So, having done a lot of this alone, there's an interest, I think, in trying to share financial and reputational risk. Some efforts through the AIIB to partner with other multilateral development banks and to do things under the Belt and Road banner. There's also been an interest in trying to attract financing from Western banks, although the Belt and Road brand has become a little bit toxic and has made that difficult for Western financial institutions to participate. The Health Silk Road is something that is now often on the agenda of official meetings between Chinese officials and their counterparts, and you'll see readouts of meetings that say we've agreed to jointly promote the Belt and Road and its Health Silk Road. I think it's important to point out here that the Health Silk Road has only become higher on the agenda in the aftermath of the pandemic. There was no really coherent health infrastructure dimension to the Belt and Road. And in official documents, health issues have received relatively little attention. So I think there's a document from 2014 or 2015 that's about 14 or 15 pages long, and health policy issues get about a paragraph in that document. It was mentioned, that countries participating in the Belt and Road should share information to prevent the spread of pandemics. Obviously that didn't happen efficiently. And so I think this is being rolled out now more to compensate for, a failure than something that is going to really have a real integrated physical dimension. And then finally, there's been a set of responses from the US side over the past 2 years that I think there's been a transition from only criticizing the Belt and Road to, I think, trying to offer more alternatives. And so in that category, everything from the creation of a new U.S. Development Finance Corporation to, the U.S. Export-Import Bank is operating now and it hadn't been. The announcement of this Blue Dot Network initiative about a year ago, which is a cooperative effort between the United States, Japan, and Australia to certify projects, and in doing so to try to catalyze private sector financing for those projects. It was announced over a year ago. Very little has actually been accomplished. And one of the challenges has been attracting European partners into that effort. But I think for reasons I can get into if people are interested, I think that may become more feasible next year. So there has been a relatively positive shift from only criticizing and complaining about this to trying to think more practically about offering alternatives, but certainly a lot more to do there. And so Juan and I leave it there, and really interested in hearing everyone's thoughts and questions and comments. Thank you.
Great, wonderful, Jonathan. So the floor is open. Please raise your blue hand in the participants tab here on Zoom. And if you're on YouTube, put a message or a question in the chat. Let me start with my colleague, Dick Samuels. Dick, over to you.
Thanks, Taylor. And thank you, Jonathan. That was very interesting and I learned a lot. I'm a Japan specialist, and I don't want to be too parochial, but I was very pleased that you reminded us how far ahead in certain important areas of Southeast Asia Japan is on infrastructure investment, ahead of China. I think that also extends to smart cities and promoting smart cities throughout the region and around the world. They've been doing it for more than a decade, maybe a decade and a half. But in recent years, you know, Japan's aid to the region has gotten has become more militarized, or it started from a zero base, so it's become militarized to a small extent. Certainly not to an American extent. But the question is, you didn't mention militarization, the military role, maybe the role of military-owned, state-owned corporations in any of this. And I'm just wondering if you could say a few words to us on the role of the PLA in the Belt and Road Initiative, or any related initiatives, aid initiatives that the Chinese have more generally. Thanks.
Great question. You know, I think there's been a lot of anxiety around some of these infrastructure projects, because a lot of the nature of a lot of these projects are that they're dual use, right? And so, you know, a port that is well equipped to handle large, cargo ship is also potentially well equipped to handle, a naval vessel. And so I think on the one hand, some of the anxiety has been understandable. I think in Pakistan's case in particular, I think the PLA has played a much more central role in managing that process. And I think they've tried to lean on Pakistan's military to be more involved in that process as well. I think in other cases, I think that the main actors have been Chinese state-owned enterprises who are more interested often in just building something because they get paid to build stuff. When I started looking at projects like Hambantota Port, which gets a lot of attention, I think I was tempted, working at a national security think tank, to want to put projects into one of two buckets, one where they're, this is a commercially motivated project, or this is, something that's motivated by ulterior motives and sort of strategic motives. And I think the reality is that it's more complicated than that. There's also, a bucket of projects that are built and serve neither a commercial purpose nor, necessarily have a ton of military value because of the actors who are involved, and, they want to build things and get paid and they don't care. So I think that that's probably, there's probably more of that happening than there is of the projects that really will become militarily important. I do think though that the digital infrastructure is an interesting area in which there are examples of white elephant digital infrastructure projects, but a lot of the digital infrastructure to me has maybe more strategic value for intelligence purposes, potentially, an ability to gather data. If you look at China's willingness to finance government buildings in other countries, so I see a much closer connection in some of those. It'll finance a government building and then provide the network hardware like it did for the African Union. Those are very high value targets. I think the strategic motives for those cases are maybe a bit clearer. And, a lot of this comes down to needing to look at projects really in great depth, which a lot of people don't do. I mean, it's a real art to it. And I know people at MIT do it. And I know people at the Naval War College do it. But you really need to look, closely at individual projects and not jump to conclusions about, this is clearly a military play or not.
Great, thanks. Next question is from Emma Campbell-Mon. Emma, over to you.
Thank you so much. This has been a fascinating presentation conversation. I actually have a follow-up question from that. How much control do you see the CCP having over SOEs, and how do you go about studying that? I know it's been a point in the literature, and so I'm curious as to when you're looking at this question, how you sort of disaggregate what is CCP initiative, and what is sort of the SOEs generally investing?
Yes, I think this is another central question where actually more research would be helpful. And, you know, so I think that there's an overlap in these sometimes, you know, the heads of large state-owned enterprises are also members of the party. And in some cases, the heads of very large state-owned enterprises will actually outrank, you know, an ambassador in a country. And, you know, they have, if you think about their influence, you know, the fact that they're responsible for lots of workers and, you know, they carry a lot of weight. And so I think that it's been, at least one of my, you know, one of my learning points here has been just the amount of influence they have on the ground is, I think in many cases exceeds the Chinese government apparatus that's supposed to be supervising them. And, you know, I think there could be, if China were putting together a larger bureaucracy to manage projects overseas, I think, you know, it might indicate that they were, you know, asserting more control over this, more oversight. I also think though, as the level of project activity declines, it becomes a little more feasible for Chinese officials to do, you know, the due diligence that they want to do. But, you know, 2016, 2017, when just projects are getting shoveled out the door, I think there was much more attention being paid to let's identify projects and get them going than monitoring them. And that really does put it in the hands of these state-owned enterprises. My colleague, Jude Blanchett, is doing a lot of work on this question of, you know, the control mechanisms for control between the party and Chinese state-owned enterprises. And I think he's gonna have a series of case studies that he publishes over the next year, looking at companies in energy and transport, maybe ICT infrastructure too. So I would recommend that work to you as well.
So speaking of the Naval War College, next we have Peter Dutton.
Oh, thank you very much, Taylor. And Jonathan, really terrific work and terrific presentation. This is the third time I've watched it because it's so good. I want to come back and check in with a couple of different things. One of them is Pakistan. One of the ways that I'm wondering whether we should think about Chinese investments in Pakistan is less in terms of the discrete success of individual projects than the overarching relationship that China is attempting to build in Pakistan, and that that in the context of that relationship, the projects will proceed on, you know, sort of in the context of the relationship rather than necessarily along discrete lines of each of the different projects. And in fact, I wonder whether China sees their investments in CPAC as more of an investment in peripheral security than an investment in commercial viability in the long run. So I just wanted to offer you that thought and to emphasize what a great project this is.
Thank you. No, I think it's a fascinating point. And, you know, in the chapter of the book, when I look at Pakistan and, you know, do a lot of, I compare sort of the US experience there, going back to, you know, the 50s and 60s, where I think there are some interesting parallels there, where I think Western economists had a similar level of overconfidence going in there, thinking they were going to, you know, help Pakistan, you know, develop rapidly. Similar level of overconfidence that NDRC officials had, you know, going in and designing CPEC. But there are some big differences just in terms of national interest, right? You know, it's on China's border. You know, China can't leave in the same way. And so I think that you're right that there probably is a broader interest in stability rather than, you know, narrow commercial success. I've also seen, you know, a willingness among Chinese officials to think about projects, as you're suggesting, not as one-off, but to try to think of them as, you know, bets on the larger country. So to give you an example, if, you know, a Western investor were looking at building a port in Gwadar, they would say, There's no supporting infrastructure. This is, this is a bad bet. And, this is a huge undertaking with very, probably pretty little upside. I think the Chinese look at something like that and they see, an opportunity to strengthen relations with, Pakistani leadership to maybe, maybe bring some economic opportunity to that region. Although we could talk about whether that's been ultimately stabilizing or not. And they also look at that project, not as just the port, but they look at the lack of supporting infrastructure as an opportunity. We'd love to build that stuff too. And so it's sort of a broader like portfolio view than just a, the individual project. So I think you're definitely, you're onto something there. But I also think that, Pakistan has done a great job of, generating support from outside partners for decades and has very similar problems that remain. And so I think China's ability to really generate change there, it's going to have some limits.
Great. Thanks. So we got lots of blue hands up and more questions in the chat. So I'm going to group questions in pairs for you, Jonathan. So I'll call on two people, let them each ask their question, then I'll turn it back to you. So the first group here will be Eleanor Freund and Nick Ackert. So Eleanor, over to you, and then to Nick, and then back to you, Jonathan.
Thanks so much, Jonathan. This was a great presentation. So I wanted to ask about BRI investment and Chinese political influence on the ground in countries where it's invested. So something I've been thinking about a lot in recent weeks, and a case you talk about in the book is Ethiopia and China's involvement in building telecommunications networks in Ethiopia. And its interest in Ethiopia is kind of like a locus of Pan-Africanism. Obviously, AU is headquartered in Addis. And recently, Ethiopia is in what it looks like the opening stages of a civil war. So I am interested in whether you have seen increased interest from China in political developments on the ground in places where it's invested, or if you've seen interest from the countries themselves in having China either mediate or be involved in political developments within the country. Thanks.
Nick.
Thanks. Hi, Jonathan. My name's Nick. I'm a second year in the program, and my own research interests involves China-ASEAN relations. So I found this enormously helpful for kind of conceptualizing how I thought things were going down on the ground in Southeast Asia. My question is, I think you present a very compelling case that, this project is becoming increasingly unwieldy and is sort of falling apart at the seams. And this is supported by empirical data. So if we know this, I have a sense that the Chinese, of course, must know this as well, and yet they continue to persistently push the project. And so I think the narrative that you frame makes a lot of sense, that they're in too deep, that this is a face issue for senior leadership, and that they can't kind of escape. But then you also mentioned quite right that the pandemic would have kind of given them an easy exit. And my understanding of the literature, I'm thinking of what Stephen Walt has written on the origins of alliances, further suggests that basically financial aid and even to some degree societal level infiltration doesn't really affect the decision making of allies. So what do you think else might be going on here besides, is there another explanation, sort of going back to Peter's question, as to why China would be taking actions that may not necessarily be in its financial or strategic self-interests, or are they just sort of kidding themselves?
Great. So two great questions. On the first, in terms of involvement in domestic politics, I think it's going to depend on where you look, at the risk of at the risk of punting entirely on that question. But the examples that come to mind are in Pakistan, for example. I think there's evidence that China was willing to I think there's been if there's a pattern, it's a willingness to work with whoever's in power and, to help them remain in power if that opens opportunities. And so in Pakistan, I think there's evidence that some power projects were announced on timelines that were actually not very practical, but intended to help with, Pakistani leadership re-election prospects. That they actually, it didn't work out. But it seemed like China was willing to help. And that's one of the benefits of the China model for delivering these projects is they're able to do it faster and sometimes to work on political timelines. They've also, in some cases, used these projects, you know, the lack of transparency makes them, you know, conduits for funds. And so, you know, they were using projects in Malaysia to help keep, you know, an indebted, a dangerously indebted leadership afloat. Yeah, I think in Sri Lanka as well, there's been a willingness to back projects that clearly serve very little commercial purpose. You know, we all hear about the port in Hambantota, but there's also a cricket stadium and an airport, all of them named after Mahinda Rajapaksa. And so, you know, clearly an interest there in maintaining relations. I think that there's ample evidence of, you know, using these projects to make friends in high places and to try to keep them there. You know, I don't think that this idea of non-interference holds up. You know, non-interference would be not going there and not doing these projects. Nick, to your question about what's going on here, I think that there's a political challenge to calling this thing a failure, right? There's political challenge to cutting losses. So that part's understandable. There are also still some interest groups that benefit from doing these projects in the short term. You know, their short-term interests are not necessarily aligned with you know, China's longer-term interests. And so I would put in that category some of the large state-owned enterprises who, you know, again, just the major priority is to build things regardless of, you know, regardless of the ultimate result. And then there are some shorter-term political benefits to, you know, having something to offer countries. So I think, you know, those are some of the reasons why this continues. It's also, you know, the demand for infrastructure, right? You know, if you're focused on ASEAN, I think the Asian Development Bank estimate is that, you know, between 2016 and 2030, developing Asia alone needs something like $26 trillion of infrastructure investment. And so just the continued need there from recipients, you know, that set of pull factors also makes this something that's more difficult to cut off, because, you know, they're asking for investment and project opportunities as well.
Great, thanks. So this, for our next pair, which will be Rachel Teacott and Roger Peterson. Rachel, over to you.
Thank you for the talk. You've touched on this question already a bit in the presentation and an answer to some of these previous questions. So just briefly, I'm interested in the anxiety on the US side that Belt and Road projects translate into a kind of influence over partners that will disadvantage the US politically and strategically. And I know there's a lot of debate in the literature about whether and to what extent this is a legitimate anxiety. So could you just unpack a little bit more, how do Belt and Road projects, to what extent, how precisely would they, don't they, translate into the kind of influence that causes anxiety on the American side? Thank you.
Great. Roger.
Yeah, this is picking up on Rachel's question, so it's a good pair. But I spent a lot of time in the Western Balkans, which you touched on briefly. It's sort of odd to see thousands of Chinese workers in Belgrade. But the question is, what are the politics of this? You weren't very clear on why are the Chinese so aggressive in the Western Balkans? I mean, the Serbs, for instance, who are not in NATO and not in EU, they like to use the Chinese as leverage against the EU, against NATO, as far as getting benefits. So how do the Chinese actually, what are they doing in this part of Europe? Are they exploiting vulnerabilities? Are they just, hey, we're just peaceful partners for integration, but what's the larger political competition in our world today on that?
Thanks. So, you know, on the Rachel's question about the anxiety here, you know, I think that sometimes, you know, the highest, most, you know, the biggest critics of Belt and Road, I think, are sometimes unintentionally generous to Chinese officials in suggesting that this is, you know, so well coordinated and that, you know, they're just building influence everywhere. And I think obviously we see that it's a lot more complicated. But there, you know, there are avenues for influence through these projects. You know, just a few that come to mind, you know, everything from, you know, I mentioned the Malaysia example of funneling money to, you know, sort of making friends in high places. Yeah, I think the prospect of participation in this of economic benefit has had some political impacts. And I think it's interesting. It's a real contrast to how the US has been using its economic power in recent years. You know, this is all inducements and it's, you know, you see it working even in members of the EU, you know, getting countries like Hungary and Greece to weaken common statements against China. So there's definitely, I think there's an avenue for some political influence. Some countries will take positions supporting Chinese diplomatic priorities. There's a set of, you know, sort of, I think of it separately from the political impacts. There's, you know, some standard setting that's going on too that could be important for commercial purposes down the road, happening both, you know, at a higher level through, you know, involvement in international organizations to just like on the ground, just widespread adoption of Chinese equipment and technology, that having some potential longer term impacts. And then, you know, there is this, you know, there are these debt issues, which I do think that, you know, I do think that debt does provide another avenue for influence. China has been a very irresponsible lender to a lot of these countries. You know, it's not a member of the Paris Club. It doesn't disclose as much information about its obligations. And I think in the great renegotiation that's happening now, what I worry about isn't necessarily lots of asset seizures, because at least the data suggests those are very rare so far. But there, you know, there's definitely the opportunity for quid pro quos behind closed doors, as, you know, China's deciding whether or not Chinese lenders are deciding whether or not they want to delay debt payments or eventually do any kind of write down. What, you know, write downs is much rarer. So I think that's another, definitely another avenue for influence. And then there's the cases where projects succeed. You know, they're commercially successful projects. And I think those examples can sometimes add to, you know, can improve China's image in the recipient country. Sometimes there are economic benefits that come from it, but there are also some limits to those projects. So, you know, I mentioned the Port of Piraeus being one of the most commercially successful projects. But it's interesting though, if, you know, you go to a port, I'm always struck by how few people there are. You know, a well-running port is kind of like a, you know, mechanized symphony, and you don't need to hire lots of people. And so, you know, the Port of Piraeus has had positive economic spillovers for Greece, but it hasn't been, you know, hiring lots of Greek workers. So there's some limits there, I think, to those positive impacts. Roger, to your question about, you know, what is China up to in the Western Balkans? We've done two reports on, you know, what the economic activities are, and then one report on Serbia, because, you know, that's been the locus of most of the activity. And, you know, I think that there's potentially, again, you know, a range of interests. Countries like Serbia that, you know, are candidates for joining the EU, you could think of them in a way as a training ground. You know, Chinese companies have been not successful getting access to, you know, the EU market to do projects, large projects there. So in a way, this is sort of a training ground for them. You know, the more that they do in Serbia, if Serbia ultimately becomes an EU member, there's an opportunity for them to ride some of that, you know, access into the EU. But in the meantime, there's this tension between that longer term possibility and some of China's activities, which are making Serbia's EU membership more difficult. And so I think you see this tension there between, you know, doing things like, you know, building a coal-fired power plant in Serbia, which, you know, a Chinese company is happy to do because they have excess capacity, but that not aligning with, you know, EU environmental standards. There's also, in some cases, you know, Serbia, at least on the digital infrastructure side, there are, Serbia is pretty prominent in terms of how data flows across the region. So there are some Serbian telecom providers there who, you know, if they purchased by the Chinese, there's some potential, you know, strategic benefit there. And in the meantime, yeah, deploying cameras in Belgrade, there's probably commercial incentives for doing that, you know, helping improve China's algorithms for facial recognition and other applications. And so, you know, I think as Chinese companies face more scrutiny too in more advanced markets, especially the tech companies, places like Serbia, who are still open for business, I think become more attractive.
Great, thank you so much. So this will end sort of the live stream portion. My